Ham Radio Now, episode 240. 60 meters. Let's go Dutch. Brennan Price, ARRL Chief Technology Officer. You're not chuckling at my introduction. Let's go Dutch.
There are plenty of thoughts that I've had about the result on 60 meters, and I smiled. I didn't overtly chuckle.
Okay. I didn't have your picture on the screen at that point. However, before we start that, I need to point at Arvin back there. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. It's also brought to you by my co-host, the mouse, who's going to be clawing at my legs if I don't put her up here. Brought to you by you, so if you enjoy the programs, get something out of it. HamRadioNow.tv is the place to go, and you can make a contribution. You can join our Patreon, and done with the pitch. The primary purpose of today's conversation is to talk about the results of the World Radio Conference that happened last November, WRC 15, in which the ham radio community worldwide got the tiniest little sliver of 60 meters. But at least we have an international allocation. I'll let you talk about that in detail. But before we go there, as the first representative from the ARRL to appear on the program, since this all happened, the league has a new president and a new CEO. And you know one of those guys, right?
I do know Rick Roderick, our new president, very well. I've had the pleasure of meeting Tom Gallagher and Y2RF, our CEO-elect now. And I've worked with Rick for a number of years, ever since I first came to the league staff in 2000. He's extraordinarily energetic, has a number of ideas, is going to make a phenomenal president of ARRL, I think a truly historic one. Tom is a very impressive individual. He certainly has an impressive resume, and he is as impressive in person as he is on paper. In the brief conversations that I've been able to have with him, it is quite clear that he's got a grand image for amateur radio and ARRL. And I look forward to getting to know him a little bit better and putting some of his ideas into practice. It's going to be an exciting time at the league, and we're feeling good about where we're going.
The league president is policy. The league CEO is execution of the policy within the organization. Which one do you work with more? Do you end up with both, or do you work with one or the other more?
I tend to work as a Northern Virginia staffer, I tend to work fairly extensively with both of them, probably the CEO a little bit more because the CEO is my direct report, but the president by ARRL convention and by our bylaws is responsible for the direction of our Washington representation, and that's not just the legislative effort, that's our international effort as well. So I have worked extensively over the tenure in my current position with both Joel Harrison and Kay Craigie and Dave Sumner, of course, and look forward to be working with Rick Roderick and Tom Gallagher in the future.
Yep. And you reminded me, I want to give a hat tip to Kay and Dave, who are leaving their respective positions. Kay Craigie as president, Dave Sumner as CEO forever. He's been CEO for a long, long time. So let's say something about those guys.
I will profoundly miss both of them. Kay has also been around in league leadership for as long as I've been involved in the league as a staffer, and her wisdom and judgment in many issues that transcend the range of issues that face amateur radio are unparalleled, and she will really be missed. Dave has a broad range of experience in amateur radio. He has accomplishments that literally cannot be matched. No matter how much time one spends in Geneva for a World Radio Conference, no one is ever going to match the 11 weeks that he spent in 1979. Dave Sumner falls into the category of people who can't really be replaced. They can, however, be succeeded. I don't view myself as my predecessor's replacement. Paul Rinaldo certainly falls into the category of people who can't be replaced. And, you don't replace people in this business, you succeed them. And I think we've identified a great successor in Tom Gallagher, and we're going to go from there.
Yeah, each will have their strengths and leave their legacy, make their mark. Because absolutely. Otherwise, we have to say we're all just going downhill. We don't want to say that.
Yeah, you have to resist the entropy's arrow, if you will.
Did Dave go to this WRC? Was he there?
Dave was there for 3 days. It was a busy time in November, and with the selection process for his successor ongoing and a budgeting process that was ongoing, the timing simply didn't work for him to be there more. But he was there for 3 days. His input was valuable over those 3 days, and he will be he'll be missed in the CEO role. We're hopeful that he'll be available in a volunteer capacity going forward in international work. It's certainly something that he has an interest in and something that he'd be well suited to in retirement if he decides to do so. And that's entirely his call.
Okay, so he hasn't talked about what he might be wanting to do.
We're not prepared to talk publicly about what okay. he might be wanting to do, but I hope that we're able to make some kind of arrangement if Dave is amenable to that, because he brings a skill set that is invaluable.
Yeah, I don't expect him to pull a Johnny Carson on us and just kind of disappear.
I would be sorely disappointed if that happened, and also surprised.
So the other thing I wanted to mention or talk about very briefly is, since you're up in Washington, do you follow the local domestic stuff very much, the hearings in Congress that have been going on, particularly, I'm thinking, involving the Parity Act?
The legislative advocacy falls outside of my bailiwick. That said, I do try to keep up with it. Passing any piece of legislation is a time-consuming and difficult task. And by any measure, we've had greater success in our legislative advocacy than we have in years in the current session of Congress. That doesn't mean it hasn't been without hiccups. I think you've shared some video on some of your previous programs that may have illustrated some of those hiccups. But we also have to consider where we are and make an effort to get around things. The issues that we're facing are not issues that aren't faced by other organizations trying to pass legislation. And there are ways to work around them. And I'm confident that we have a good team trying to bring our antenna effort home. And that is something that is going to have long-term ramifications for amateur radio as private deed restrictions proliferate, as private developments become more common. The argument that amateurs have a choice to live various places really loses steam. And I think as time moves forward, that's going to be a false argument. There's not really going to be much of a choice if we don't gain some relief.
But among the hams, there's a surprising amount of opposition to the Parity Act. I don't know what the actual numbers are, because, you know, small minorities can get very vocal make a big deal. But you put anything on QRZ.com and they come out of the woodwork and they are flooding the channels with complaints about big government stepping on private contracts.
Well, one of the things you need to think about when it comes to big government is that the entire system of radio regulation exists because of big government. We do not have rights to the airwaves simply because we are who we are. We have rights to the airwaves because there is a national and international regulatory scheme that parcels things out to various types of licensees. We inherently exist because of governmental action, and this is not something that offends me as particularly sweeping. Yes, I know there are people out there who have their views. They are not correct. And I'll leave it at that.
Oh, okay. Very clear statement. All right, let's get to the business at hand. I was listening to the program that we did last year, just about this time. It was like a day or so, January 31st, I think, last year, in preparation for the World Radio Conference. And I was really hoping that I would be able to talk to you throughout the summer and several other times, and I just never was able to put together the time to do that. But at that point, this point last year, we were hoping for a 200 kilohertz allocation, maybe 150 kilohertz allocation. And but many, many things were in play. We hadn't heard from there was a notice of proposed rulemaking or something from the FCC. I got the language wrong, but the FCC had an inquiry out looking for comments. We hadn't heard from the NTIA. And then all that finally happened before leading up to the World Radio Conference itself. You know, I mean, I think maybe we buried the headlines. I did mention that we got a 15 kilohertz allocation. Is there any other headline comments that we want to, that we ought to toss in before digging into the details?
Well, we did achieve an allocation, and allocations are tough to achieve in the current environment. And I think when we dig into the details, most notably the EIRP restriction, we will see the difficulty in obtaining an allocation, particularly one that is vigorously opposed by a non-trivial number of countries. Clearly, the result was not what we would have liked. I am not upset that we got an allocation of only 15 kilohertz. I would have liked the power restriction to have either not been there or been something much more reasonable. That said, the result that you see is what happens in a situation where you need to obtain consensus in order to move forward, and one very vigorously opposed country, or in this case a block of countries, can hold up progress despite having a group of countries, a larger group of countries, supporting doing something.
Who was opposed? Who were the countries that didn't like it?
Particularly the Russian Federation and some countries in Europe, and as well as some countries in Asia. Asia was sort of all over the map. And we did have strong regional support for allocations coming in, including three-digit allocations from support from Europe and the Americas. However, that support, as broad as it was, turned out to be a little bit thin. We spent a lot of time arguing over the expanse of the allocation, to the detriment, really, I think, of having a good discussion about what the restrictions would be. And by the time the expanse of the allocation got settled, we were essentially out of time when we came to the amount of time that was allocated by conference management to resolve this issue.
Did all of these negotiations, were they at Geneva, or was this what was going on throughout the summer and leading up to November?
Well, there are preparations and negotiations that go on throughout the summer. Before the conference, the effort is to try to achieve regional consensus on these issues. And that's what happened within CTEL, our Organization for the Americas. It's what happened at CEPT. We also obtained affirmative proposals out of an organization called the Arab Spectrum Management Group, which represents about 20 Middle Eastern and North African countries, as well as the Africa Telecommunication Union. Now, the terms of that support were either a lot more vague in the case of ATU or a lot more restricted in the case of ASMG. We also had support from the administration of China for a narrow allocation with some fairly substantial power restrictions. And the outcome of WRC was actually closest to what the Chinese administration put forward, although their power level was 3 decibels off of what China proposed.
So the United States position was eventually hammered out to be no change.
The U.S. position was hammered out to be no change. It was a little bit more nuanced on the ground than a simple no change position. The U.S. no change position was essentially a position saying, look, we are not going to support a broad allocation, and the amateur community seems to be talking about a broad allocation. And we were told when the allocation gets narrow enough, we will support an unfettered allocation without any onerous restrictions. I candidly think that was a pretty good deal. And in fact, there was some effort made by the United States at the last regional meetings to modify CETEL's position to a narrow allocation without restrictions so that we could get the support of more countries. Yes, we had an inter-American proposal. Yes, we had a European proposal. But it turns out that there were not as many countries backing those proposals as there could have been. And when the negotiations started happening in Geneva, it became clear that the strength of support for those positions was not as firm as we would have liked. Once we got to the point in Geneva that we were talking about a 15 kilohertz allocation as opposed to a 175 kilohertz allocation or a 100 kilohertz allocation, the U.S. actually reversed its position as they had suggested that they might, and they argued passionately and persuasively, in my view, against the power restriction. Unfortunately, they came on side too late, and that's not really their fault. They made very clear that they wanted to hear of a number that was more like 25 or 15 rather than 50 or 75 or 100 or 175. Looking back in retrospect, was it an error to try to get a 175 kilohertz allocation? Did it turn some people off and make it difficult to progress? It may have. I think that was probably a fair criticism. And I think the takeaway lesson from WRC 15 is we're going to have to reevaluate how we attempt to gain new bands going forward. In 1979, you could take votes. A vote hasn't been taken at a WRC since 1995, I believe. And one very determined country can really dig in their heels and force an outcome that is not what we would like. Now, that said, I don't think the outcome is entirely bad. We do have a band. Bands are inherently more flexible than channels. We do have the possibility of influencing the domestic rulemaking to try to combine the best of both worlds. And I do think we have to remember that in most countries of the world, the default on 5 megahertz right now is a 0 kilohertz allocation with 0 watts of authorized power. So is this a gain for the world's radio amateurs? Yes, it is. Is it a good result for U.S. hams? That depends entirely on the domestic implementation, and we have our work cut out for us.
Okay, I'm going to attempt to bring up a chart that I made here, and whenever I do this sort of thing on the fly, I worry that I'm going to screw it up. Are you seeing this chart okay?
I'm seeing the chart okay.
Okay, so this is, it looks a little complicated. What it shows is, let me put... where I can stick my finger on it. These big red lines are the current U.S. allocation of the five channels.
Correct.
And this cyan block here is sort of what the one of the original proposals of about 250 kilohertz,
175, and that's what we would have liked, and that's what the Americas formally asked for. Yeah.
Yep. Across the bottom here is just kind of a smattering of the allocations that have been over the years authorized by a variety of individual countries. And now none of these were WRC allocations. It's just as amateur radio made the requests to their respective governments, those were the things that were allocated. And you can see that it's quite a hodgepodge. It's all over the place.
Yeah, and as a matter of fact, having that hodgepodge is one of the is in the long term a problem which we wanted to solve at WRC and did to the extent we were able to get an allocation. All of those various country allocations that you see there were made under an international provision known as Article 4.4, which essentially gives you no protection against anything. The status of having an allocation in the table is something which is highly desirable in terms of being able to negotiate reasonable access to spectrum, having at least some status with primary users, and more importantly, with unlicensed users. The status quo really wasn't tenable in the long term, and as a matter of fact, the no-change countries really did have an incentive to solve this at WRC so that all the amateur operations would eventually be consolidated in one place or toward one place. That's better for amateurs. It's better for incumbent services, in my view. And having a hodgepodge of country-by-country regulatory schemes really isn't healthy for amateur radio operation in that band in the long term. It was fun and useful in the short term, but it's just not tenable throughout or once you gain a critical mass.
So, okay, let me go back to the chart if I'm can keep from screwing it up too badly here. So this wrong button.
Wonderful control.
Thank you. Lost control. So this block here, this dark blue block, is what's the WRC allocation, which sits right around our what we on 60 meters call channel 3.
Right.
And this yellow block here is what the Dutch administration immediately after the conference was over said, we're gonna give this to our hams with 100 watts. They were basically thumbing their nose at, I'm trying to manipulate my system here and I need a technical director. Thumbing their nose at the WRC is the way I read it. They said, screw you guys. We don't like what you got. And here's what our hams get now, which is why I say 60 meters. Let's go Dutch.
Well, I am very pleased that our Dutch radio amateurs were able to persuade their administration to go in that direction. The difficulty is outside, beyond the constraints of the WRC allocation, outside of those bounds and outside of the power limits, those authorizations are going to be under Article 4.4, which has the issues that we were trying to solve in the long term at WRC. Now, that's not necessarily a bad thing. One of the things that I anticipate ARRL will be asking for domestically is some continued access to at least one or more of our channels so that we have reasonable power for voice communications in situations where we need reasonable power for voice communications. I think we've shown that we can make such an arrangement work, but we're going to have to overcome the result of WRC 15 in order to do that. The Dutch hams have certainly gained a win in the short term. I hope they're able to maintain it in the long term. But once again, we do have a number of other countries that may argue at some point that they want to rely on the outcome of WRC. I hope they can make it last. I am glad that they were able to make the argument. The CEPT spokesperson for the 5 megahertz issue at WRC 15 was actually from the Netherlands, former IRU Region 1 president Hans Blondiel Timmerman, PB2T, who spoke persuasively and passionately for as long as CEPT would let him on this issue. It reflects a great deal of work on his part and on Dutch ham's parts, and I hope they can make it work in the long run. I am quite certain that's not going to happen in the United States.
Did their position, their arguments come up? Well, I guess you were saying he was arguing passionately, and I guess it was for this broader allocation and higher power limits. So you could see at the conference the direction they might have been going.
Early in the conference, the organizations, the regional organizations that were proposing a broad allocation, decided to harmonize their positions. CTEL immediately came down to 100 kilohertz, and for a while ASMG and ATU were also arguing in favor of 100 kilohertz. And that just simply didn't get the critical mass that we needed until we whittled down to 15. And by that point, the there was no time really to have a meaningful discussion about power. There was a suggestion made saying, look, we could get several more countries on board if we went down to 25. Would I have been happy with an outcome of a 25 or 15 kilohertz allocation without a power limitation? Yes, I could have legitimately come home and sold that as a win to United States radio amateurs. It's difficult to sell the result as an unqualified win on 5 megahertz. We did have successes on other issues that I hope we can talk about before our hour and a half is up. But, you know, 5 megs is certainly a mixed bag, and how it turns out depends entirely on domestic implementation, and we're going to fight really hard in order to maintain meaningful voice access.
Yeah, I do want to talk about the other things that happen, because not getting things is part of the deal, and not losing things is part of the deal. But before we get to that, I was wondering if the idea of actual interference, the whole idea is of setting these spectrum pieces apart, enough being secondary is to prevent interference to ongoing primary users. Did any examples or discussion of actual interference from radio amateurs ever come up at the WRC?
I've heard a couple of circumstantial issues that were never discussed on the floor and were candidly addressed on the fly by both the radio amateurs and the primary services involved. We do have a reputation of being a good sharing partner with the federal users here in the United States. And I think that reputation is credited by most countries around the world. The argument that was made on the federal side against a broad allocation was that they have systems that have a low duty cycle, but that in their view absolutely need to work without question when they are used. And their argument was, look, we think you're good sharing partners, but we need to keep you in a narrow band so that we know where you are and we can move vital systems out of that band. And, you know, the argument, or at least the United States argument, was centered around making sure that federal government systems had the reliability that they feel that they need. They admitted that the probability of interference given our practices was pretty low. Pretty low was not good enough for them. They needed certainty. And their argument was, hey, if you go into a narrow allocation, we'll be able to deal with that. And I proposed during domestic discussions, look, do you need to have a power limit? Do you need to have some sort of protocols? Do we need to have other terms of the resolution? And they kept on saying, no, if you're in an area of spectrum that we know about, we can work around that. And the magic number for us is around 25. And I thought that was one of the best arguments that I heard on the no side, candidly. It was a lot easier to work with than the absolute no that we were dealing with from countries like the Russian Federation and some other countries scattered throughout the world. One can only second guess whether having the United States on side would have made any difference in the final result. It certainly would have meant we were going in with a lower number of kilohertz, at least. I would have hoped we would have been able to get in exchange a higher number of watts. But the discussions didn't work that way. We're going to deal with the result. And it's not a terribly bad result. Once again, this is a band. And as somebody who operates with low power into compromised antennas because of my setup at home and in my car, the prospects of using some digital modes on a band like this are really appealing to me. To an emergency communicator who likes to use 100 watts of voice on the U.S. channels, I could understand how they would be concerned.
Yeah, this, so many thoughts coming through my brain, and I can't get them all out at once.
I understand. It's a complicated issue.
Well, what we're seeing here, and I'm dealing with a cat as well, what we're seeing here is we don't know what the U.S. is going to do with this proposal. And it has happened with the WRC-12. Something comes out of the WRC that doesn't instantly flow into U.S. regulation. It takes a while.
We're working on implementing the results of WRC-07. it's going to be a while before something gets implemented in the United States, I believe. And until then, the domestic regulations are what they are. Don't start doing PSK off the center of a channel just yet. It's going to take some time to implement whatever we're going to implement in the U.S. We do have a good track record, we believe, under our existing Article 4.4 channels of being a good sharing partner. And we believe that we can make a good case that having authorizing full-powered voice communications on one or more of these channels is beneficial not only to radio amateurs, but also to other users of the spectrum who may need to communicate with radio amateurs in a in an unusual situation. So I think that's what we're going to be arguing when the time comes. I don't want to preempt the ARRL board's prerogative, and the time hasn't quite come yet. There are things we can argue, and I think there are things that we will argue. That being said, I think the world is eventually going to coalesce on what came out of the WRC, and I think a fix to the power limitation is going to be a longer-term issue. I'm trying to be hopeful and realistic at the same time.
All right. Yeah, I was going to try to say that we may not lose the channels that we've got now, but it sounds to me like you're saying the likelihood is that eventually we will lose everything that's outside of that 15 kilohertz.
I won't say that it's likely. I'm saying that it is a possibility. Any exception to the any deviation from the outcome of WRC is a deviation from international treaty text.
Yeah. And that is something,
which is what the Dutch did, and is something which any country can do, but we're going to have to make the case to do it. And in a lot of countries around the world, the default is the treaty text. Essentially, the ITU radio regulations make for a ready-made regulatory scheme that a country that doesn't have as much resources or as detailed of a rulemaking process as the U.S. or Canada or the U.K. or the Netherlands can essentially use off the shelf. And I expect that a lot of countries will be using the result off the shelf.
All right. So We'll have to wait until proposals get made and regulatory stuff happens.
And it's not going to happen soon.
It's going to be years.
It will be years.
Yeah. At WRC-12, that's where we saw the international allocation at 137 kilohertz and 470 approximately.
137 was actually WRC-07, and is one of the things that we're looking to implement right now, along with 475 kilohertz. There's an active rulemaking. There have been some discussions after that rulemaking, and not anything where we can be confident about an outcome yet. I will say we have some justification to be hopeful about an outcome, but we're not at that stage yet.
Does what happened at this WRC with 60 meters and getting the 15 kilohertz allocation and a fairly low ERP limit, which I'll say is useless. 15 kilohertz is about what we've got now. If you coalesce the five channels down into one band, it's 15 kilohertz amount of spectrum. 15 watts or 25 watts, that's useless. That does us absolutely no good for voice operations. For digital operations, yeah, perhaps. But that totally changes the character of
It certainly does change the character, and I will characterize it as disappointing. I will take issue with the characterization of useless. it certainly is not. It is not ideal for voice communications. That being said, you're talking to somebody who has DXCC using hamsticks on the back of his car and an FT-817. So it with some of those with voice contact. It's amazing what one can do with amateur radio. I must concede it is not ideal, but I do not want to lose sight of the flexibility that a band inherently has over channelized operations. I will be firm on that.
Okay, but I don't want to make this the main part of the debate.
Fair.
But if you're talking about eking out the last little bit of working a DXCC, that's one thing. If you're talking about reliable emergency communications, which is what 60 meters originally was our point, that's something different.
I agree with you there, and that I think you've identified the argument that we're going to make in order to continue to have access to at least some of the channels on our current terms. And we have reason to believe that there are some people on the federal side who may be receptive to that. Are we going to keep all of them? I don't think so.
They're working, right?
Can we make an argument to keep some of them? I think we have a good record on which we can stand and a good reason for it. And I think that reason jives with what the nuanced position that the United States took going into WRC 15.
Yeah. Those channels are working.
The channels are working for voice communications under restrictive conditions. For people who want to do other things, and we try to accommodate all interests within amateur radio, it's pretty onerous right now. That being said, we have an outcome which provides some opportunities and offers some peril, and we'll deal with it.
Yeah. I mean, when other modes were added to it, they were added stupidly. And the a single Morse code signal in a 3.5 or 2.5 kilohertz allocation doesn't make any sense. A single PSK signal doesn't make any sense. And the only argument that I heard about doing it that way was, well, we have to be able to identify what the signal is and get it to go away if it's causing interference. And if we have multiple signals within that spectrum, that's going to give us a problem. That is baloney.
I find it difficult to disagree with you there.
Okay. I've been wondering I operate 60 meters a fair amount, and no one's ever rang my phone or come on the frequency on voice and saying, Gary, we need the frequency for federal use for a few minutes. Would you mind standing by? I don't imagine that's actually how it would happen, but how would it happen? I'm sitting there operating and the feds need it. What do they do?
You'd have to ask the incumbent users about what they would do. I have heard an anecdotal story of a group of amateurs stopping communications when somebody came on and said, "Hey, we're the Army." That's only an anecdotal story. I haven't actually heard it over the air, and I think the fact that we don't hear instances of that much, if at all, is reflective of a few things. First of all, I think amateurs are good sharing partners and responsible operators, and you can tell when something weird is happening on a or within a secondary allocation. Second of all, I think incumbent federal operations may be adjusted at this point to minimize the use of these particular channels. I do know that in the long term, they'll be looking to minimize the use of the band that has been allocated, particularly for systems where they see that they need or where they perceive they need a high degree of reliability. And finally, there are a lot of ALE type systems in use on the federal side. And maybe the feds don't use our channels when they're in use because they detect they're in use and they go elsewhere. You kind of have to wonder whether the existing differentiation between primary and secondary services really makes too much sense if you have an ALE type of situation where the secondary service is indistinguishable to the computer from the primary service. The question is, does that make a secondary service de facto primary? That's kind of a philosophical question that I'm not sure that there's really a practical answer to. At any rate, it's something to think about.
Yeah, I don't think they're... I don't think they're going to worry too much about changing who's primary and who's secondary. They're going to keep that. But yeah, I agree. They have probably moved whatever they've got going on to just stay away from our spectrum.
And the difficulties increase at HF because compared to the microwaves and above, where you can use directional and steerable antennas and spread spectrum and all kinds of techniques, you've got skywave considerations at HF, and you can't get around them. The same things that make 5 megahertz attractive to radio amateurs are the things that make 5 megahertz invaluable to incumbent users. We had widespread agreement among federal agencies and radio amateurs about why hams wanted and needed access to this particular area and why incumbent services needed it as well. It's hard to solve interference issues at HF, and I wish I had the tricks that some of the microwave people have to apply. Yeah. It would have made the cause simpler than it was.
And here we go into another sunspot minimum. When that piece of spectrum becomes ever more valuable because the higher frequencies become less and less useful. We can go on forever with 60 meters. I think we probably beat it to death, at least so far. Is there anything else about that we haven't covered before we move on to the other things that happened to WRC?
I would love to talk about the other things that happened at WRC because I feel better about those outcomes.
So what else? What were we looking at going in, and what eventually came out? What ended up as a surprise?
Well, we were looking at the possibility of some fairly significant restrictions on several of our microwave allocations, if not restrictions, then negative impact. And I'm thinking particularly at 10 gigahertz. 24 gigahertz and 78 gigahertz. We managed to get outcomes that if they weren't no change, and in a couple of instances they were no change, they were outcomes where we entered into a sharing situation which was tolerable. So we feel good about being able to maintain meaningful amateur access to those bands. At 9 centimeters, 3.3 to 3.5 gigahertz, for the last several years, ever since 2007, the fight for amateur access as IMT, essentially cellular telephony, smartphones, moves into those bands. The fight for amateur access has been a country-by-country fight. It's been a fight which we've won and we are continuing to win in the United States. Other amateurs in other parts of the world are having either better luck or worse luck, but we're doing okay, and we've managed to hold off the juggernaut to an extent that we continue to enjoy meaningful access to 9 centimeters. And I'm most thankful for our ability to shape the outcome of the 2019 conference in a positive way. There was a potential item actually it did end up being an item for spectrum for small satellites, which have, for a variety of reasons, been accommodated within the amateur satellite allocations, and the situation has become increasingly untenable. And the initial thought was, or the thought at some point during the process, well, we could just normalize this by putting everything in the amateur satellite allocations. And if we legitimize the status quo, that would be almost a son of little Leo outcome. That would require a great deal of resources and personnel to defend over the next 4 years. In the end, we were able
to... You went by a son of little Leo outcome. I've been tracking you pretty well up until that point. What are we talking about?
Fair enough. And actually, little Leos predate my involvement in amateur radio, so I'm kind of showing how relatively young I am here. But the late 90s, the low Earth orbit satellite community sought to have access to the amateur satellite allocations for a whole variety of reasons. And that was would not have been a good thing for a healthy amateur satellite service. It was something that was resisted at AWRC and was eventually abandoned. The item that's on tap for 2019 seeks to identify spectrum for operations purposes and telemetry purposes for a variety of communication satellites of all kinds of applications. And we were able to steer the spectrum that is under consideration outside of the existing amateur allocations. And that is something which anyone who uses 2 meters or 70 centimeters anywhere in the world should be thankful for.
There's been a little bit of news about the possibility of a geostationary satellite carrying ham radio. Now there's one that is proposed, and I think in pretty far progress. That was talked about at the Tapper conference at the Tapper banquet last Dayton that Qatar is putting up. And yes. We'll cover Europe and Asia and Africa. And now we're talking about one for for the Americas. What I was thinking of was that most hams who are more concerned about working in Palmyra and Heard Island are going to go, huh, what are we talking about here? But this is kind of our future. The spectrum that will get us up and down to satellites, especially geostationary satellites, which is going to be a big deal for the next generation of ham radio.
Well, a geostationary or geosynchronous satellite would certainly be a game changer for the amateur satellite service. And you have identified the two projects which are close enough to coming to fruition. And those projects were actually something that we had in mind on one of the items at WRC 15 where we were playing defense. They were looking to accommodate an expanded Earth exploration satellite service for surveying the Earth essentially with higher resolution from space. And they were looking to expand the current allocation into 10 gigahertz. One of the potential outcomes was to have that expansion go all the way to 10.5 gigahertz. Now, for terrestrial 10 gigahertz uses, the Earth exploration satellite service is only a nominal problem. In an 11-day orbital period for a typical Earth exploration satellite, the interference potential to a typical amateur terrestrial station is going to be about 15 seconds out of that 11-day orbital period.
That's not acceptable. I want to play argumentative country at the WRC. That's not acceptable. 15 seconds is too long. 5 seconds. We'll accept 5 seconds.
Well, no.
Does that sound familiar?
It does sound familiar, but it's for being a secondary allocation to begin with. That level of interference is the least of our worries. We're more likely to get stomped on by a nearby radar here in the United States than we are by an Earth exploration satellite. That being said, when you get into the satellite segment from 10.45 to 10.5 gigahertz, that is a problem. And since they were talking about EESS being primary and the amateur satellite services secondary, we were very worried about causing interference to them and not being able to have meaningful amateur satellite access. They did, after some discussions, move downward. The upper edge of the EES allocation is 10.4 gigahertz. They had essentially moved 500 megahertz up from their existing allocation and expanded 100 megahertz downward, met their needs without killing the potential for amateur GSO systems at 10 gigs. And that was a considerable win and required some effort.
Is it difficult to go into these negotiations with a potential amateur use on our side and a very real current system use on their side, where they're saying that we're using this, you guys are just talking about it?
Well, the good thing about amateur radio and having 3 million radio amateurs worldwide and 740,000 some odd amateurs in the United States is you've got a variety of interests. And there's somebody using the band out there for something. Whenever I get this allocation is not used argument at an international level, I can knock it down fairly easily, even without recourse to satellite systems that are only planned. That is, people have learned not to try that game with us. That being said,
you probably have to keep teaching that lesson though over and over again.
It comes up about once a cycle, and it lasts for about 2 hours, and then they retrench and they think of a new one. That being said, the GSO projects, while they are inherently fraught with uncertainty, a lot of things can happen in the term between now and launch. You have to get an actual launch vehicle. You have to develop the satellite to the ground stations and rely on a lot of moving parts. That said, the people who are behind the two projects that you have mentioned so far have made more progress on this front than I can ever remember being made in my involvement with amateur radio. There are reasons to believe that good things are going to happen on that front, and it is a proposed use, but you know, other services cite proposed uses as well, and you just have to make a judgment as to whether those proposed uses are likely to become reality. And we have a good argument there.
So we've got
at least as good as some other commercial services.
We've got satellite interests. We've also got terrestrial interests at 5 and 10 gigahertz. I'm not sure how much terrestrial stuff goes up very much above that, but we're starting to see places in the country that are setting up, I guess they call it Hamnet now. It used to be HSFMM, and they're trying to brand it a little bit more comfortably, or more something that people can understand. These would be mesh networks and fairly small local systems, but that can grow across a region, and they're using that spectrum as well. So you had arguments to make to protect that spectrum or to try to keep it?
We have arguments to make to maintain meaningful access to that spectrum. All of our allocations everywhere in the world between 440 megahertz, which is the end of the primary 70 centimeter allocation in Europe and elsewhere in Region 1, to 24 gigahertz. Everywhere in the world between those two frequencies, all amateur allocations are secondary. One of the things that is challenging in this line of work at that particular spectrum is coming up with arguments that carry the day when you're trying to defend spectrum that you don't really have to begin with, where you have to constantly shuffle or come up with operational techniques to avoid interference with primary services. That said, we do have a story to tell there. The HSMM effort, an Hamnet effort here in the United States is something which is real, which is tangible, and gives us something to argue for. Our regulators tout the virtues of broadband. This is how radio amateurs are taking broadband into their own hands for their own benefit and potentially for the benefit of others. So there's something to be said there. And it's carried the day, at least domestically, so far at 3.4 gigahertz. We're going to have to make that argument again at 5 gigs, where there are several interests eyeing spectrum in 2019.
The secondary status that we have had on a lot of our bands has been fairly secure for a long time because the primary users were military. And while the military didn't use that spectrum a lot, they weren't going to let it go. They're starting to let it go.
Sometimes they're being persuaded to let it go, or at least let other countries let it go. Here in the United States, I think we have a better footing on 3.4 gigahertz, 9 centimeters, than we do in a lot of countries around the world, because our military does have some uses there. That being said, I think they're shifting their uses into the spectrum that is authorized to radio amateurs, as opposed to spectrum, say, above 3,500, where I think in the long term, mobile broadband is going to become prevalent. That's not necessarily a bad thing. I would rather share with a bunch of radars any day over a bunch of cell phones, because cell phones are everywhere and they raise the noise floor. There is a possibility on some of our bands, particularly the higher bands of the future, where that could happen. And it scares me. Now, there are more tricks at, say, 47 gigahertz than there are down at 3 in order to try to use steerable beams and cognitive systems in order to coexist. That being said, the military is being a little bit more nuanced in their approach. I would say the bands where we have access to are bands that seem to be somewhat important to them. And I do know that our military friends were very helpful on the small satellite issue, in keeping 420 to 450 megahertz off the table. They were willing for a little while to throw 146 to 148 under the bus, but we were able to fend that off without them. So
yeah, I was going to ask if because we've been talking about esoteric space that most hams don't deal with and may not in their lifetimes, but it'll be important in the future. What has been going on the spectrum that we use all the time, 2 meters and 70 centimeters and the HF bands, were it sounds like some of that got dealt with early. Was anything else really still up across the spectrum that we consider to be our, you know, prime time territory?
So far as issues in our prime time territory, we had the 60 meter issue, which we've already talked about, and we had the small satellite issue, which we've managed to neutralize in terms of WRC-19. The first item on the agenda for the 2019 conference is a potential harmonization in whole or in part of the 50 megahertz allocation worldwide. That's an effort by our Region 1 colleagues, and that's going to be spearheaded really by Region 1 folks as opposed to anybody at ARRL or elsewhere in the world, because they're the ones who are actually seeking the allocation here. They do have an allocation by footnote in a lot of countries, but not all the countries, and with television converting to digital, they do want to revisit whether it's possible to somewhat harmonize the amateur allocation around the world. It's going to be a tough fight, but I think it's one worth having, and I think it's going to be one that's a little bit easier than the HF issue, because the higher you go in frequency, the less sky wave you have to deal with.
Let me hold on just a second there, because you've gotten into a territory that I'm actually pretty familiar with, and that is the television spectrum. I don't know if most hams have been paying careful attention or not. I like to broaden my interests beyond what's going on just inside the ham bands. But very briefly, to summarize what's been going on, is that when we converted to digital, almost all television moved to UHF. There's still a few high VHF and one or two low VHF stations that have gone digital, and I think they're going to regret it that they didn't move to a UHF channel. And we are trying to concentrate more and more broadcast television into fewer and fewer channels, made possible by the fact that you don't need to have an empty channel in between two TV stations, two TV channels in one location anymore. You used to have at least one empty channel between two because of it, adjacent channel interference problems. Not a problem anymore. So now there's all this spectrum from 56 to 108 megahertz or so that is lying pretty fallow. And I'm not hearing big drum beats by potential users to say, let that go and give me that spectrum. Does somebody want that? Is it, it's a bit of the armpit of the radio spectrum because of the propagation characteristics, so that, you know, every couple of years gets slammed with F2 and then that goes away for 8 years. But do people want it? Does anybody, and in terms of, you know, things like Wi-Fi and stuff, the antennas are too long. But somebody must want it besides us.
Well, yeah, the antennas being too long don't seem to deter some Wi-Fi folks, and probably more importantly, our regulators. Mobile broadband seems to be first in line there. That being said, as you've said, there are a few television stations that are still on low VHF, and until that changes, and I see some obstacles to complete clearance anytime soon, I think the possibilities of a 70 megahertz band, which I get asked about a lot, more often, frankly, than anything else.
Yeah. There is one in Europe, right? A ham band of 70 megahertz.
It's not anywhere in the international table. It's authorized on a country-by-country basis.
Well, it's a 60-meter kind of thing at this point.
Yeah, and it's a hodgepodge as well. That is not going to happen anytime soon here in the States. We've got other irons to work out and more low-hanging fruit that we need to work on. Now, that said, I have a foolproof way for any United States radio amateur who has an extra class license to work 70 centimeters. Get your CEPT paperwork in order. Go over to a country that authorizes, not 70 centimeters, 4 meters, 70 megahertz. Go over to a country that has a CEPT licensing scheme and operate to your heart's content. It can be done if you're gung-ho about it. It just can't be done here.
But nobody's using it here.
Nobody's using it here. There are a few legacy television stations, and once the television stations move out, I think the overcoming the broadband juggernaut is something that is going to be difficult. The practical and political realities are such that it's simply not going to happen here anytime soon.
Yeah, the hams aren't going to do this, but the money is there from all of the other potential users to buy out these TV stations and just throw them away. Or, you know, buy them a UHF transmitter, put up a new antenna, get them out of the way.
Well, there
seems like an easy thing to do.
They're actually talking about making some of the UHF transmitters go away so that they can have more mobile broadband there.
Well, they're doing that too. The 600 megahertz band is about to go away from TV.
And I think that you're going to see 470 and up begin to be instead of auction.
And that gores my ox, because this little transmitter in here is 626 to 656 megahertz. And I only get to use this for another year or two before that goes away, and Gary gets to buy a whole new set of wireless microphones.
The wireless microphone industry is being very vocal about identifying some replacement spectrum, and I've heard anecdotally that at least one member of that industry said, gee, I think we can share with the amateurs, and they will have to persuade my dead body about that, but that is an issue.
This little transmitter, it's a couple hundred milliwatts, and it's frequency agile, but I put this on, say they give wireless mics the 70 centimeter band. You know, put this on the input to a repeater frequency, and I'm keying up repeaters all over town.
You can you can share ham radio now with the world. Or at least with the triangle area.
Yeah. What else happened at this WRC? Anything else that you guys protected us from devastation that we won't recognize you did until for years?
I think I've covered the main points. There are a WRC has a lot of moving parts. There's a reason why it takes 4 weeks. We weren't confident of a positive outcome on the small satellite issue for the next conference until the final work day of the conference, and well into the final day, work day of the conference, around noon. So it was a very hard effort, required the input of a number of people from around the world, including my colleague here at Baja ARRL, Jonathan Siverling, WB3ERA, whose guidance of a number of new delegates to WRCs for the amateur cause was invaluable. We had a team of about 12 radio amateurs in the capacity of radio amateurs from around the world in attendance, representing essentially all continents. The team was very dedicated, worked very hard, and I was proud to be a part of it.
We got to get John on ham radio now sometime, maybe with you. You've been the star here, and you've mentioned him every time. And I've yet to even talk to him. So does he Skypes?
I will pass along the invitation to John. So far as I know, he hasn't been able to make Skype work on his laptop. And I hope he'll be able to do that at some point in the future. John was described to me at the recent board meeting as the most valuable asset ARRL has and that nobody knows about. John's efforts transcend his expertise that he's developed in Latin American relations and telecom in general. He also serves on the board of the United States ITU Association, which is an industry association that has a lot of power players, the Boeings of the world, the Lockheed Martins, the AT&Ts, the Verizons, are all there trying to develop consensus industry positions on a variety of ITU issues. And ARRL has held a seat on that board for nearly a decade now, either in the form of Paul Rinaldo or me, or now John Siverling. And John's expertise is valued by the people within that organization, and he has earned election to that board in a field of really greats of the telecom industry. So the fact that ARRL is taken seriously in this atmosphere is no small feat, and John has a lot to do with that.
When you say at the board that they said he was the most valuable person in the league that no one knows about, it probably applies to all of you guys.
It does apply to a lot of us. There are a lot of people who work hard on issues that are not usually visible.
And I have tried on a few programs to get this out to the ham public that is willing to spend the time to watch it, which is going to be a pretty small number. I mean, we're sitting here pretending like we're a serious program when maybe a few hundred people are going to get to this point of the broadcast and understand what we're talking about, which is sad. It should be thousands, but it'll be a few hundred. A few thousand will start. I will drop off as they go along. But what I was going...
You need to get more scintillating guests than me.
You're a great guest, and I love having you on. And what I wanted to say was, when people say, well, why... And I see this now and then. We all see this. Why should I join ARRL? Why should I be a member? What good is it doing me? Well, this is what it is. And the reason that you don't understand it is because you just don't see it. This is not visible enough. And it is hard to make compelling programming out of this kind of stuff, but That's the reason C-SPAN is not competing heavily with NBC. Yeah, it's just hard to do.
It is deep technical stuff, and I do want to thank you, Gary, for the opportunity to try to present it in a way that will be meaningful to the radio amateur who doesn't do this every day. It is a worthwhile thing to do, and the most rewarding thing that I've done in my professional career. And it's vital that someone does it. As I said, it's no small feat that amateur radio is taken seriously in the background against which we work. And we only are because of the tireless work of several people over the years, the Hiram Percy Maxims, the Richard Baldwins, the Larry Prices, the Dave Sumners, the Paul Ronaldos, and the Jonathan Siderlings. It's something.
And the Brennan Prices.
And I'll accept some small credit for that too. We are in a good position to make the case for what we have and to make the case for what we need. We don't always get what we want, but we're not left out of the room either. And that's no small feat. We are taken seriously on the international stage and on the domestic stage. And that's only possible because 170,000 some odd radio amateurs feel that it's important enough to support with their membership dues each year. Yeah. So I never forget that I am there only because members make it possible for me to be there. So thank you.
If we look across the history of ham radio, there have been some serious inflection points where the league has saved our bacon. Very early on, when the Navy wanted all the spectrum that was available to be used, at the end of both world wars, when ham radio was basically shut down, and the league said, get us back on the air. And then in perhaps less overarching ways, but piece by piece, every decade has got an example of something that the league has done that has kept us in business as ham radio. And I don't know when it was happening, if people paid as much attention then as we're not paying attention to what you're doing now. So I suspect that we have a better historical perspective on it. And someday someone will unearth this conversation on YouTube and said, that's why we can talk through our satellites.
Well, it's a small reason why one can talk through the satellites. It provides the framework and the actual work to build and launch and negotiate platforms for the things is non-trivial. So the ability of radio amateurs to contribute to amateur radio, each in their own way, is one of the great things about what we do. And I hope and try through my work at ARRL to enable people to contribute in whatever way they want. There are a number of people who really get into the technical investigation aspects. There are some people who simply like rag chewing and don't get into things much more than rag chewing. There are people who like Morse above all, and that's their thing. There are some radio amateurs who are only radio amateurs because they want more frequencies with which to control their model aircraft. There is a broad spectrum, pardon the pun, of desirable and worthwhile uses for amateur radio. And I want everybody to be able to do what they want to do. And that's one of the great things about...
We don't expect everybody to be fascinated by what you do or to even want to do it themselves, but we are glad that you're there doing it.
Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity to talk today.
Last question. Has the snow all melted yet?
The snow is getting close to having melted. We had close to 28 inches here in my QTH at Vienna, Virginia, and that was in an area that where snow removal has not advanced to the art where it's advanced to in places like New England. after waiting 2.5 days without a plow coming through my condominium complex, the residents of my building got fed up, took shovels in hand, and cleared our parking lot in about 3 hours. I took 3 hours off of work last Tuesday afternoon in order to be able to move my car to the road that had been cleared since Sunday. So it is... it has passed, and we're getting back to normal here.
Yeah.
At Baja ARRL.
I'm a little bit Baja ARRL.
That's what I call us. John and I, the Northern Virginia folks.
And I guess I don't understand.
Baja California.
Yeah. Okay. You're the little slice of ARRL.
We're south of New England. So. Yeah.
Okay. And so I'm a little bit south of you, Raleigh, North Carolina area. And yes. I went skiing last week. Down here we got ice, and I just managed to get out of town on one of the only airplanes leaving town, and for some reason mine left on time. The taxi that came to our the black helicopters are going over, and I got the window open. I'll explain why. The taxi wasn't able to get up the little hill I'm on because, of course, you know, being in a good ham, I live on top of a hill. So we had to roll all of our luggage down to the bottom of the hill to get in the taxi and then get to the airport and went skiing. I have come back. It is going to be 70 degrees today. Today is February 1st, 70 degrees. What the heck?
It's supposed to be above 60 here in Northern Virginia. So it's certainly been a week to 10 days of weather extremes.
Okay. I will see you in Orlando. Understand you're going to the national convention.
I hope I'll see a number of viewers as well.
All right.
Have a chance to say hi.
Okay. Thank you, Brennan. Let's
thank you, Garrett.
Wrap this up. And Arvin sitting back there still saying hamradionow.tv. Stop by and click the pig and help us out. If you enjoy programs like this, you got to be pretty wonky to get something out of these, but I think they're pretty special. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. This guy here is Brennan Price, N4QX. Over. And you want to say the out part?
Sure.
I say over and.
I got it. Let's go ahead and try and do it.
Okay. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
I'm Brennan Price, N4QX.
Over.
And out.